Are you a team in WWE? Do you want to go on to become the WWE Tag Team Champions, whether that's male or female? Well, no, because every tag team that's in WWE is getting broken up. Why? Because. Seriously, what's going on?
You're a burping gutter slut.
Yippee-ki-yay!
Oh my God! I'm something about it.
What's up, everyone, and welcome to another Tops and Bottoms. My name is Joey Mayberry. I am your dad bod demigod, and I am coming to you to bring my top five moments and my bottom five moments in the world of professional wrestling and rank them all. I'm going to dive into the best characters, the best storylines, the best matches, and also flip that around and talk about the worst characters, the worst matches, and retribution. Can I say that covering professional wrestling's tops and bottoms over the last few months has been a heck of a chore, but it's really, really kept me on my toes because let me tell you, some of the things that you think are going places just kind of go off of the rails, and some of the things that you think are just gonna go off the rails tend to go places. So let's see what happened this week. There's a lot to talk about. Let's dive right on in. Top moment number five was the tag team match that we got between Drake Maverick, Killian Dane versus Ever Rise this week on NXT. This is so much fun. I love this pairing of Maverick and Dane. It's a lot of fun and I cannot wait. Cannot wait.
Oh my God, I can't wait.
For the moment that Killian Dane decides he's going to be Drake Maverick's partner and just dances along with him because, guys, that dance is everything! It's so much fun. It's like a ska kid dance in the middle of this happy little go-lucky thing. And this is just happiness. And honestly, I need a little bit of happy in the world of professional wrestling because it's all been like separations and drafts and seriousness. There hasn't really been just happy, a happy wrestler. Thank you, Drake Maverick. I love this.
Whoa! Oh, no! This is carnage out here.
Wait a minute, back in the ring!
Top moment number four was the main event from NXT. It was Rhea Ripley teaming up with the returning to the ring Ember Moon to take on Dakota Kai and Raquel Gonzalez. Woo! Ember Moon's return was great. It was spot on. It was a great way to thrust her back into the women's division by teaming her up with someone as established as Rhea Ripley and putting her up against an established tag team of Dakota and Raquel. Now, I'm going to go ahead and make this assumption that I think that Raquel and Dakota are destined for the main roster sometime after the draft, if not this Monday. It's time for somebody to really be able to step up to Baszler and Nia, and I think that Shania Payne would be in for a fight against Dakota and Raquel. But it was great to see Ember Moon back as well. Ember Moon looked great on her return. She looked like she hasn't missed a beat. The Eclipse hit. Ah, I've missed the Eclipse. So good. Such a good finishing move. Love everything about it. I don't know if the little feud between Raquel Gonzalez and Rhea Ripley is going to continue, but I look forward to it. If so, solid match. Very happy with the trajectory of the NXT women's division.
Making me sweat here.
The door is open right now for Brian Cage.
Oh, true claw. That, buddy.
Yeah. Leg hook, shoulders pressed.
Top moment number three was the match for the FTW Championship that opened up Dynamite this week. It was Will Hobbs taking on Brian Cage, who is the enforcer of Team Taz. Two big boys going at each other in just an organically built way. Instead of just saying, hey, both these guys are big, go have a match, doesn't make much sense. This was great. It was built via the entire feud that Moxley is having against Team Taz. Darby Allin coming out at the end to save Will Hobbs from the attack of Cage and Starks. Love all that. All of this is great. This is such a just well-built feud, because all of these people have a substantial reason to hate each other, and I love everything about it. I'm excited for this six-man that's probably going to, like, tear the roof off of someplace, because honestly, Hobbs, Allen, and Moxley versus Cage, Starks, and... who else? Archer? Archer?
Where are they?
Let me tell you, a six-man where it's Archer, Cage, and Starks to face Moxley, Hobbs, and Allen. I'll take it every day of the week, baby. You can keep giving it to me.
Big E with a big ending! A big ending! Through a table! The cover! Big E with the win!
Top moment number two was the Falls Count Anywhere match between Big E and Sheamus on SmackDown. Thank you. Thank you for just giving me a match that was just good. Because honestly, I hate this storyline between Sheamus and Big E. Hate it, hate it, hate it. But this match, take away everything. You know that these two hate each other. And that's all I needed for a really, really good match. It sucks that the New Day is getting split up. I'll talk more about that later. But I really, really enjoyed all the fallout of this. Big E looked like a superstar. This was such a good move to build Big E in a way like this, because he showcased himself fantastically. Even when the car didn't break like it was supposed to at the end, the cover, we're just picking him up to hit that big ending through that table, get that three count. Love it. Thank you, Big E. Big things are in store for Big E. I don't see much for Sheamus coming out of this, because honestly, Sheamus has bored me, and I hate to say that, for the past couple months. So hopefully more coming for Big E, kind of seeming like it's going to be idle for Sheamus, but God, this match.
Oh my God, that was such a rush. I'm alive!
And it was kind of fun to see Big E turn into a cake. He's a big old cake man. And we've arrived to top moment number one. It was MJF interrupting Chris Jericho's speech during his 30th anniversary celebration on AEW. Y'all, this was peak MJF. He's such a dick. Just this self-absorbed character that everyone can relate to, everyone hates, and I love it, love it, love it. Him coming out to interrupt Jericho's speech after he got the victory on his 30th anniversary AEW special. But how do you make that better? You have a clown deliver him a painting of yourself. Yes.
That's right. Keep moving.
You know what? You know what? Yeah.
Check you. You stay.
MJF versus Jericho is going to be such a good feud. I can't tell you how excited I am each and every time these two interact, because the match itself is going to be spectacular, because it doesn't require any in-ring competition to build it. These two simply have to talk and be the fantastic characters that they are, and you get money. Cash money.
Cash money.
So those are the tops for the week. What did you guys think? Do you agree with me? Leave a comment right down here. Also, go ahead and hit like this video right now. Hit that like button and hit that subscribe button so you're notified anytime I post new content. Because if you liked all the positivity, it's gone. It's time for the negative. Here come the bottoms.
The bottom!
Get up!
Go! Hey, what?
Oh my God! Ali with Retribution!
Mustafa Ali directed Retribution!
Bottom moment number five this week was Mustafa Ali becoming the leader of Retribution. Now, I'm gonna go ahead and state that this moment in particular was good. It was well written, well built, fantastic. But that doesn't ignore the fact that just because you decided to stick Mustafa Ali as the leader of this group this week, that everything else in the past didn't happen, because everything in the past has been so bad and so badly written that I am praying for Mustafa Ali, and I'm hoping with all of my heart that this man is going to be able to turn this storyline around. You have a really good, solid baseline with Mustafa Ali versus the Hurt Business. You went from the height of tearing down the SmackDown set to the bottom of terrorizing superstars, to the middle of being in a feud with the Hurt Business, and you kind of just started to dip down. This Mustafa Ali can hopefully grab that, pull it back up, and put it into something great, because right now, it has all the makings to turn this feud around. But if it's not done well, it's just gonna So I'm hoping and pleading to the wrestling gods that some solid writing is going to come out of this, and Mustafa Ali can come and turn this thing around, because honestly, he is a superstar who has been neglected on the main roster. He went to 205 Live. He didn't really get to showcase himself at NXT, but he's trying to prove himself, much like everyone else in Retribution. And I hope that that can shine through and they bring that into the forefront. If they do, we have the makings of a solid, solid storyline. If it's just the makings that leads up to Retribution versus the Hurt Business at a Survivor Series match, and then it goes nowhere after that, all of this was for nothing and it was just a big pfft. Oh, that wasn't even a good raspberry. This doesn't deserve a good raspberry.
Strowman safely through the barricade. Cares about the count out. Strowman's not done.
Bottom moment number four was the exhibition match from Monday Night Raw. It was Braun Strowman versus Keith Lee. Poor Keith Lee, you have been lost in the nonsense of nonsense. Braun Strowman is on Raw. He hasn't been drafted. Doesn't make any sense. He goes up to the authority figure that is... Do I need to know his name? I guess I have to know Adam Pearce. Oh, it's Adam Pearce. But he goes up to him. He says, I want a match. Adam Pearce says, hey, you have to have an unsanctioned match. So it's just an exhibition match. What does that have to do with the price of eggs in China? It makes no sense. Then you go out there and you have Keith Lee come out and be like, I'm going to fight him. No, this... Unlike the Brian Cage, Will Hobbs storyline on AEW that had substantial build to be big man versus big man, this was just big man versus big man for the sake of having it. Keith Lee came into the main event title picture with all the hopes in the world, and it seems like he's not going to get anything out of that. This was very sad. I hope that they give him something else and that they figure out something to do with Braun, because this Strowman Express thing is just awful. Maybe they'll toss a wreath on it and be the Polar Express for Christmas.
Morgan trying to rip apart these two.
Here are your winners by submission, and still the WWE Women's Tag.
Bottom moment number three was the Women's Tag Team Championship match from Monday Night Raw, where the Riot Squad finally got their match against Shania Payne.
Let's go, girls.
Did the Riot Squad stand a chance? The answer to that is no. No, they did not. They just beat down Ruby Riott. They made Liv Morgan look like she didn't stand a chance from the get-go, which she didn't. This is just going nowhere, and there's no contenders in sight for the women right now, unless you have Dakota and Raquel come up and bring up some other women's tag teams from NXT. These belts are kind of dead in the water right now. There's nobody else that can face off for them, and I'm hoping they do something besides bring up Dana Brooke and Mandy Rose, because right now that just looks like something that's thrown together to fight this other thrown together tag team. Why do I need to care?
SmackDown selects Big E.
Bottom moment number two is more tag teams getting separated during the draft. What is going on? The New Day was split up. We took Big E, but Xavier Woods and Kofi have been drafted to Monday Night Raw. Also, Tucker has gone to Monday Night Raw, so we've split up Heavy Machinery. What is up with splitting up tag teams? Also, the Lucha House Party was split up. Who do you have? Who's going to fight the tag team champions? You need to either merge those belts or bring up some more tag teams, because honestly, what are you doing? We've seen it. The women's tag team division doesn't have anything either. I like tag team wrestling. Do y'all not like tag team wrestling? Because it does not seem like it, because everyone is getting separated. Everyone.
You mean like this? Or like this?
or this.
R. Sullivan is here. Destructive forces
and we've come to bottom moment number one, which was the return of Lars Sullivan following a very sad match, which was Matt Riddle and Jeff Hardy versus The Miz and Morrison. One, you had a really bad tag team match because Hardy teaming up with Riddle, and then Miz and Morrison have just been turned into a joke at this point with how this writing has been. And then to cap it off, you have Lars Sullivan come out and make his return, which, come on, 2020. Nobody asked for this. It was just very much a letdown all around. There wasn't really a more, meh, oh my god, this is happening segment across the world of wrestling. So this is the bottomest bottom moment for me. If y'all want to make a bottoming joke at Mitch Bennett, then go ahead and do it in the comments.
Oh my.
All right, those are my tops and bottoms for this week. What did you guys think? Do you agree with me? Do you think I'm stupid? Do you want your life spiced up? Leave some comments right down here. Also, go ahead and like this video and make sure you subscribe. And you can hit that little bell so you're notified anytime I post something new. And I'm always posting. Follow me all across the social medias. I am Joey_Mayberry across pretty much everything. You can also find me on TikTok at DadBodDemigod. Also check out Ring the Bell, where I am reviewing women's wrestling each and every week. Everyone, I love you so much. Thank you so much for watching. I will see you next week for a brand new Tops and Bottoms. Stay safe, wear a mask. Now go eat some pizza. It's time for some pizza.
I'm like, where's the pizza?